Good morning. Welcome to worship here at First Presbyterian Church, where our mission is loving God, loving neighbors, and living with purpose. A couple of announcements before we begin our time together today. First of all, at 11:30 this morning, please join us via Zoom for our annual meeting of the congregation, where we'll present our budget and elect our new officers and celebrate the successes of 2020. Anyone can join in the meeting, but voting is for members only. Again, that starts at 11:30 this morning, and you should have received your link in an email today. Now, next Sunday, March 7th, we are going to begin gathering again for worship in person, right here in our sanctuary. We are so excited to welcome you back. It will be a communion Sunday with our little communion kits. Please bring a mask and be prepared to, again, observe social distancing, but we will be together. It is the second Sunday of Lent, a season for reflection and contemplation and leaning hard into the grace of God. Friends, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us begin our worship with our prelude.
With sincere and repentant hearts, let us confess our sins against Christ and one another. God of glory, we do not always see your glory in the world around us. When we see a person in need, it is not easy to look him in the eye. When we hear a cry for help, it is not easy to offer her quick assistance. When we know of a lonely prisoner, it is not easy to make that visit. Forgive us when we fail to see you in our everyday lives. Forgive us when we are afraid to act, afraid to care. Encourage and help us to see others in the eyes of compassion, that we might be your loving presence in the world. Amen. Trust in the Lord, for God's grace is real. In the name of Jesus Christ, who is above all and in all, you are forgiven.
Well, good morning, young disciples. It is great to be with you. I have something to show you. I have with me a jar of awesome homemade apple butter. I got a new kitchen gadget that makes it so easy to make this stuff, so I've been making it like crazy lately, and I just love apple butter. And you know, the first time I made it, I followed the recipe that said, find red apples and make the apple butter. And it was great. It was really good. But the next time I made it, I took some different kinds of apples and I put them all together to make it. Because this is a sweet apple, this red one. This yellow one is really juicy. And the green one's kind of tart, and when you put all of those together, you get this amazingly rich apple butter that just takes it over the top. And you know, it would be, well, how would it be if the recipe said you have to use red apples, only red apples, nothing else? That just wouldn't make sense, would it? And you know, sometimes our world just doesn't make sense, because rather than appreciate and embrace the richness of all the things that make each one of us different, there are sometimes rules, written rules and unwritten rules, that kind of keep us separate from one another. For example, there are some people that seem to think that it's okay to treat somebody different because they look different. And people who are a different color sometimes get treated in a way that they are disadvantaged. And if someone maybe doesn't wear the right clothes, or they aren't quite as refined or aren't quite as beautiful, they're not allowed to fit in. Or someone is kind of held back, maybe because they're a woman and a man thinks it's okay to treat them that way. There's a word for that, and it's called prejudice, and it's wrong, because that does not allow us to treat others the way God wants us to treat others. God wants us to treat others the way we want to be treated. God loves all people, all boys, all girls, people of all different colors, and God wants us to love them the same way for who they are. Here in a little bit, we're going to hear Jesus tell us of a time when we will meet God in person. And God is going to walk us back through our life and show us all of those times where we loved people the way God wants us to love people. God will show us and say, you remember that time when you passed that stranger on the street who looked like they could really use a friend and you smiled at them? I saw that. And God's going to say, you remember when that woman came into your north parking lot at your church and she needed a way to feed her family and you gave her a box of food, or maybe you helped her find work, or you just prayed with her? I saw that. And as God's walking us back through those moments, we're going to feel God's joy as God smiles with us. This week, I have a challenge for you. I haven't given you one for a while, so you have one this week. I want you to find two people who are different from you. And I want you to do something that lets them know you care about them for who they are. Give them a word of encouragement. Be kind. Show some grace. Let them know you understand who they are and that you love them for who they are. Because in this world, the diversity of who we are, the differences that make us all different from one another, that really is what adds to the richness of God's kingdom. Let's pray. Gracious God, thank you for loving us for who we are, no matter who we are. Teach us to love that same way. Amen. See you guys next week.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you call us here to feed one another, to show compassion and love, to offer comfort and mercy, to give as freely as we have received. Open our hearts and minds to your word, that we may follow the example of Jesus. Amen. The first scripture this morning is from Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 through 40. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these, who are members of my family, you did it to me."
Our second scripture reading continues with Matthew 25, 41 through 46. Then he will say to those at his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me, naked and you did not give me clothing, sick and in prison and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I am not a big numbers person. For example, I'm a pretty strong competitor when it comes to charades or word games, but I'm not all that great at cards. Going to school, I loved English and dreaded algebra and geometry. In fact, every now and then I still have nightmares where I've skipped all my math classes and now it's the day of the exam and I don't know how to work any of the problems. It's terrible. And one of the appealing things about majoring in music many years ago at the Conservatory of UMKC is that back then, and maybe it's still this way, back then music majors didn't have to take any math. None. Yeah, we had to take acoustics and music theory, but not math, not straight up math. And despite all that, today's sermon is going to feature some numbers. Numbers aren't everything. But numbers do matter, and numbers sometimes tell a story that we need to hear. Numbers can move us to action and hold us accountable and do things like that in ways that words and images alone just can't do. Before we get into those numbers, I just want to acknowledge that there's a lot going on in today's parable. And I don't think it's fair to just gloss over the way the parable ends with the goats going into eternal punishment and the sheep into eternal life. It troubles us, and rightly so, because who among us is a perfect sheep all the time? Not me. The thought of eternal punishment does not fit with our idea of a merciful Savior, but Jesus uses dramatic, stern language in this story because he is running out of time. He's got a very important point to make, and he needs to get our attention. So rather than soften or ignore Jesus' words, I think we do best if we simply let them stand as they are, alongside all the other things Jesus said and did, like the story of the prodigal son in the Gospel of Luke, or forgiving the penitent criminal who hung on the cross next to his. I think we hear Jesus' words and we also remember the assurance that nothing can ever separate us from the love of God, including our own shortcomings and failures. Well, back to the numbers. Our first number today is the number 6. Jesus lists 6 actions that matter: feeding the hungry, giving a drink to those who are thirsty, welcoming the stranger, giving clothes to the naked, caring for the sick, and visiting those in prison. Those are the actions by which the nations are judged. And isn't it interesting that it's not the people in prison who are judged? It's not the people who are hungry or naked or strange on the outside. There's no judgment at all of those who are down, those who are in need, only those who didn't help them. This is pretty much the exact opposite of how our contemporary world operates today. This story is so powerful and so challenging that our denomination, the Presbyterian Church USA, started a movement several years ago called the Matthew 25 Initiative. And I hope this sounds familiar because Pat Yancey told us all about it when he preached on this very same passage last November 22nd. I hope you'll go back and listen to that sermon again if you missed it. Well, the Matthew 25 Initiative calls on Presbyterian churches to make the commitment to live out the actions in Matthew 25, feeding the hungry, caring for the sick, clothing the naked, etc. And Pat told you that our session unanimously voted yes to becoming a Matthew 25 congregation. So, here are some more numbers. We are now one of 758 Matthew 25 congregations in the United States today. We are one of 13 Matthew 25 congregations in the state of Kansas, and we are currently the only one in the city of Topeka. And while I will not be at all surprised if more Presbyterian congregations make that commitment, it's kind of fun to be the very first, isn't it? When we signed up to be a Matthew 25 congregation, we were asked to choose at least one area of focus for our work. There were 3 to choose from, and we chose congregational vitality. In other words, we hope that as we engage in activities like feeding the hungry and welcoming the stranger, that we will also become a more connected, more vibrant congregation. And to do that, we knew as a session that we were going to need to stretch ourselves a bit, so we came up with some goals. And yes, they include numbers. Now, once again, I'm not a numbers person, but I have this little thing called a Fitbit, which was a birthday gift a couple of years ago. And it tracks how many steps I take every day. A lot of you probably have Fitbits or something similar. Well, the goal is to reach 10,000 steps a day because that's a nice, healthy number to hit. It means you're moving around adequately and getting some decent exercise. But the great thing is, even on the days when I just don't have the time or the energy to make it to 10,000 steps, having that as my goal does inspire me to move more. And some days, like when I'm on vacation and have extra time and have the chance to go hiking, I double my goal and aim for 20,000 steps. But again, even when I fall short, tracking my progress motivates me and lets me know how I'm doing. In that spirit, your session has set some goals for 2021. And if you read our monthly newsletter, you've heard them before. Our first goal is that our church would provide 100,000 meals. 100,000 meals in 2021 sounds crazy, but this number is meant to stretch us and challenge us. Everything counts, and we estimate that each box or bag of food that we share as part of our Wednesday food distribution ministry contains about 20 meals. We've shared about 200 bags and 240 boxes so far this year, so already our church has provided 8,800 meals just through that one ministry. And if we add to that 707 pounds of food that you donated at our drive-through Super Bowl of Caring, and if you add 60 Silver Wings roast beef dinners we delivered, plus 75 pancake dinners, pizzas for the 80 teachers and staff at Williams Magnet School, plus all the food our members have placed in the blessing box so far, plus the pizzas that the Family Ministries team delivered to the families of our church with younger children, we are at or beyond 10,000 meals, and that is using a very conservative metric because I would rather underestimate than overestimate. It may well be closer to 11,000. Now, we do have a ways to go to hit 100,000 meals by the end of December, and we will need to either start something new to reach that or expand something we're already doing, but why not try? Our second goal is that the people of this church would offer up 100,000 prayers. Now, praying is not one of the six activities listed in Matthew 25, but Jesus prayed all the time. Jesus taught his disciples how to pray. We pray because that's how we connect with God, and this gives us the insight and the strength to hear God's voice and follow Christ's teachings, and if we're going to do big things, we have to be grounded in prayer. Now, how, you ask, do we define and track something like a prayer? Well, believe it or not, we are actually developing an online form that we'll share with you next week to help you track your prayers. But we will also have a tracking form in the monthly newsletter each month that comes to your home for those of you who just don't do computers. And while you can expect to hear some sermons on prayer in the coming months, and while I recommend trying to make your prayer last for at least 1 minute, You get to decide what a prayer is for you, whether it's 10 seconds or 10 minutes. If 150 people in our church pray on their own or with their families for 1 minute, two times a day, for the next 300 days, that would take us up to 90,000 prayers. And we, your staff and church leaders, will be responsible for tracking the prayers of the community. For example, we have prayer in every worship service. And if 200 of you are following the service, we'll count that as 200 prayers. So this is one goal that truly all of us can help with, and one that I think is most critical to our success. Our third goal may be the most challenging. Our third goal reflects one way that our church can grow in welcoming the stranger. Our third goal is that the members of this church would extend 1,000 invitations to people outside the church. if 200 of us would extend 5 different invitations to people who are not a part of the church over the next 10 months, that's all it would take. Now, we had some discussion about whether we should insist that we invite 5 different people, or could we just invite the same person to 5 different things? And we agreed it's completely up to you. We also acknowledge that in the middle of a pandemic, it's a little more challenging to invite people to things. But here are some suggestions. If you are not comfortable to return to church in person yet, fine. Invite someone to watch one of our worship services at the same time that you yourself are watching it. You could arrange to deliver some coffee or donuts to their home as they watch, or even some communion elements just to make it a little more fun. Or invite someone to participate in an online Bible study to help with our Wednesday afternoon food distribution, or have them join you for a session of Faith and Flower, or create or suggest a church event that you would like to invite someone to, and maybe we can make it happen. If even just 5% of those invitations eventually lead to someone joining our church, that would be 50 new people in our midst. Again, stay tuned and watch your mail and email for information on how we will ask you to track this. And here's an important side note. It is absolutely fine if you invite 5 different people to do things and they all say no. Tell us anyway. We aren't measuring yeses. We are measuring invitations, because that is how we will grow in welcoming strangers. Our fourth and final goal is a big one, but it's also a lot of fun. Our fourth goal is that every member of the church receives a personal visit from a pastor or a deacon or an elder this year. And the reason we have that goal is because there's something a little bit misleading about only seeing ourselves as sheep or goats. Sometimes we are the ones in need. Sometimes we're the ones who are hungry or thirsty or lonely or sick. Great way to start seeing Christ in our midst is to practice on each other, and that is exactly what we'll do. Again, stay tuned for details and tracking. And I keep saying stay tuned, and at this point I need to give a sermon shout out to our exceptional director of communications, Carrie Reardon. We've been having conversations for the past month about how we can get the whole congregation on board with tracking our progress towards these 4 goals. And Carrie is in the final stages of fine-tuning our plan to make this as easy and simple and stress-free as possible. Every time we review our plan, Carrie keeps asking, how can we make it even easier? Meanwhile, if you would like to go ahead and get going on some of this, grab a little notebook, little journal, just start writing down the date and making a tally mark in it whenever you pray. And be thinking about who you know who might need an invitation to participate in one of the events or activities of this church. 100,000 meals, 100,000 prayers, 1,000 invitations, and every member visited. No, this doesn't cover everything, but what a wonderful start towards living into our calling to be the church that feeds people physically and spiritually. That was last week's sermon. What a great way to live into the Matthew 25 vision. Whoever you are, wherever you are, no matter what your age, abilities, stage of life, or resources, whether you are not a numbers person or you love them, you can make a difference. And in doing this, we will all be able to better recognize Christ in our midst. So let's go, sheep. Thanks be to God.
As sheep of God's fold, we have received goodness and grace from God's hand. Let us show our gratitude as we collect today's offering, an offering that continues Christ's work of mercy and compassion for all God's children. If you'd like to make a contribution to the ministry and mission of First Presbyterian Church, there are a number of ways you can do that. You can mail a check to the church office. You can drop it by the church office. Or if you're watching us online, you can click the Donate Now button right there in front of you and set up a payment online. However you give, your contribution is very appreciated. Let's pray. Lord of all, we offer these gifts to you as food and drink for a hungry world, as clothing and shelter for those who are homeless, as kindness and compassion for those who are most in need of mercy. Transform these gifts that they might be your hands and feet in the world. Send us forth as your people, that all that we do and all that we say may be a glorious representation of your presence in the world. With gratitude, we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
we come to God in prayer. Great God of all the ages, we come before you in gratitude for the beauty and warmth of the sun shining on us today, a gift that we treasure even more as we remember the cold of just a couple weeks ago. Thank you for the vaccine that is helping turn the tide against COVID-19. Thank you for laughter and pets and good food and special people in our lives. Thank you for the perseverance of people who keep hanging in there, doing their best in spite of difficult circumstances. Thank you that every day is a new chance to know you better, to praise you, and to learn to see Christ in the faces of those around us. Compassionate One, we gulp and gasp as our nation marks more than 500,000 lives lost because of COVID-19. We are mindful that every single one is precious in your sight. O God, hear our prayers and come to our assistance. Come to the assistance of everyone who needs the vaccine and can't yet find it or get it. Everyone who is suffering from any illness. Everyone who is bowed and bent under the burden of loneliness or hopelessness. Everyone who is mourning a loss. Everyone who is struggling to get by. Holy Spirit, bless this church. Help us be the church that feeds people physically and spiritually. Help us as we strive to provide 100,000 meals, offer 100,000 prayers, extend 1,000 invitations, and visit each of our members. Bless our annual meeting today, and especially pour out your mercy and courage on each of our new officers, deacons, and elders both. As we work to make our staff the best it can be, please lead us quickly to the individual you have in mind to be our part-time accounting assistant. And thank you that next week we can gather in person again to worship you in spirit and in truth. Hear us now as we join together in praying as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. If you don't have a church home and you're interested in joining us on our mission of loving God, loving neighbors, and living with purpose, if you hear our goals and think, hey, I'd like to be part of that, please contact Pastor Pat Yancey or me, and we'd love to visit with you about how to join this vibrant community of faith. Meanwhile, let's go sheep. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Alleluia. Amen.